Hey everyone, Reese here, and welcome back to Control-Alt-Reese. Now, in a previous episode, I started restoring a video music, Atari's Trippy Music Visualizer from 1977. And yes, it was a while ago, but I finally have all the bits I need, and I promise it will be finished very soon. But in the meantime, I wanted to introduce you to this, a modern open source recreation that was designed by a group called Uncommon Projects and published in Make magazine back in 2012. In this video, with some help from this project's sponsor, JLC PCB, which I'll talk about a little bit later on, I'm going to show you how this all works, how to put one of these together, and a few enhancements I came up with on my own, like this snazzy retro-styled housing. So first, just a little bit about this project. The Atari Video Music was arcade industry giant Atari's ill-fated venture into the world of hi-fi, and was released in 1977, the same year as their iconic 2600 console. In fact, it shared a few elements in common with that console, including lead engineer Bob Brown, who'd previously been responsible for the home version of Pong. But if you want to know a bit more about the story behind the video music and how it all works, I highly urge you to check out my original video on the subject, which is linked down in the description and at the end of this video. So, what is the Pixel Music 3000 all about? Well, I stumbled across this on Make magazine's website and, unfortunately, being from nearly 10 years ago, a lot of the links were broken. I went hunting for the original creators, a group calling themselves Uncommon Projects, but their website was long gone too. I actually had a bit of a job hunting down proper documentation and code for this, a lot of it involving my old friend the Internet Archive, but I've rounded up everything I can and put it up on my website, so consider this my contribution to the very limited documentation that's out there, and hopefully now it won't be lost to the ever-present scourge of bitrot. Well, until my website inevitably disappears as well. The original project was built on Perfboard, with a breadboard prototype of course, and built around the Parallax Propeller, an older but very capable 32-bit 8-core RISC microcontroller chip introduced in 2006. The Propeller supports programming in assembly, C and C++, and its own proprietary languages BlockyProp and Spin, the latter of which was used for this project. On the hardware side, the Pixel Music 3000 uses a 24LC256-256K serial EEPROM to store the program code, and an MCP3208 analog-to-digital converter to actually get the music into the thing. And apart from that, just a small handful of discrete components, including a 5MHz crystal to clock everything. To be honest, it was so simple that I actually skipped the whole prototyping stage and just drew up the PCB in KiCad and sent it off for fabrication. And you know what that means? It's sponsor time! So, as I mentioned at the beginning of this video, I had these boards fabricated by JLC PCB, a service I've used many times in the past on various projects, and I've always been genuinely pleased with their customer service, the turnaround time, and of course the quality of the end product. So when they contacted me offering to sponsor this project, of course I didn't hesitate to jump on board. So what is JLC PCB? Well, they're an online PCB fabrication service, obviously. So in my case, I drew up the schematic in KiCad, based on the original designs, generated the basic PCB, and routed all of the tracks in the usual way. Of course, your workflow may be different, and you can use any PCB design software that's capable of exporting industry standard Gerber files and drilling templates as required. Then it's just a case of uploading the Gerbers, tweaking the options including funky colours like the blue I'm using here. Then you can sit back and relax while their state-of-the-art production facility manufactures your project to your exact specifications. But don't put your feet up for too long, as in my case the boards were with me within a week. And here is the end product, a lovely blue two-layer PCB. Now, I didn't opt for any of JLC PCB's assembly options, that wouldn't make for a very interesting video after all, so I'm going to assemble this myself the old-fashioned way. I bought all of the parts from RS Components, apart from the propeller which I found on eBay. But to be honest, there's nothing too exotic here, and it should all be available from your friendly local electronic component stockist. The complete bill of materials is available on my website, which is linked down below in the description, but I've also put them up on screen here for your perusal. So in no particular order, I'll start soldering things up, including the 5MHz timing crystal and a potentiometer, which is used to adjust the sensitivity depending on the volume of the input. Next up, I'll add the 3.3V regulator, which is an LM2937. This will accept an input voltage all the way up to 26V, but it will generate a lot of heat in that case, so the original designers recommend a 6V PSU. And who am I to argue? To get some power into this regulator, we'll need a barrel jack. This one actually wasn't quite the right footprint for the one I picked in KiCad's library, but I managed to bend the rear negative pin back slightly to get it to fit securely into the board. Now I'll add these two electrolytic capacitors, which are decoupling or bypass capacitors, on the voltage regulator to make sure those incoming volts are lovely and smooth. This side of the board is getting there now, so I'll add the two resistors, the 8-pin socket for the EEPROM and the power LED before moving on to the other side. To be honest, I'm pretty much just assembling this in the order that the parts are coming out of the box. There's no right or wrong way to do it. Next up, we need a 40-pin socket for our propeller microcontroller. These are always fun to solder. I like to do the first couple of corners sideways before turning the board over to finish the rest. Nearly there. Now we add the 16-pin socket for the analog to digital converter. This component takes the incoming analog audio signal and turns it into a bunch of ones and zeros that the propeller can understand. Then there are a couple of pin headers and the last few resistors, but I forgot to hit record for that bit for some reason, so here's a shot of the finished thing. I'm pretty sure you've all seen more than enough to judge my soldering abilities by now anyway. So now it's a case of programming the thing, and there are a couple of ways to do that depending on how familiar you are with the propeller ecosystem, but this circuit is designed to use Parallax's own prop plug connector, which is basically a USB to serial adapter. As I'm new to all this microcontroller stuff, I decided to play it safe and just go with this, as it's the hassle-free option. The prop plug plugs into a dedicated 4-pin header on the PCB, and then it's just a case of opening the spin project in Propeller IDE. Here we can see the code on the right and the dependencies on the left, including external libraries to handle the TV output, graphics drawing routines, and the input from the MCP3208 analog to digital converter. At the top, we can check that the prop plug is being successfully detected on COM3. And then to program the EEPROM, just click the green right button or press F11. It's a fairly small program, so it flashes past pretty quickly, but you'll know soon enough if everything has been successful because it's time to test. I wired up a very quick connector using a 4-pin DuPont socket and a TRRS connector, which connects to a standard Raspberry Pi composite cable. There's actually a little shortcut we can take here, as the inputs and output are connected directly to each other. It's a straight pass-through. So for testing, we can get away with just the one cable for audio input and video output. And it works! Unfortunately, due to my choice of copyrighted music, that's all I can show you. So it's about time I put together an enclosure for this, and I found this rather nice one on eBay. I was surprised at how sturdy it was for the price, and although it's a little on the large side for my needs, I don't think massive boxes with barely anything inside are completely unprecedented, particularly in the world of hi-fi. It does have some mysterious dents in the plastic despite being brand new and well packaged, but I guess that's always the way with this cheap Chinese stuff, and I'll just make sure the better side is at the front. So first up, I need to deal with the fact that it's completely the wrong colour. So I sprayed the various plastic parts black, and although it was pretty dark outside, I'm really pleased with the way it came out. After drilling holes for the buttons, power, input and output sockets and LED, I covered the whole thing in this rather tasteful wood grain vinyl. Incidentally, the same stuff I use for my little JVC PVM. Then it was just a case of fitting the board inside the enclosure with some self-adhesive PCB standoffs and wiring everything up. Of course, it doesn't have the front panel knobs and buttons like the original, and that's definitely something that could be added with some future improvements to the hardware and software, as the propeller has plenty of inputs. I didn't have any panel mount power sockets in my parts box, so I decided to go with a trailing cable, although to be fair, this is similar to the original video music, so it's not all bad. It could do with some strain relief, which I'll sort out later, but I'll just be gentle with it for now. And that brings us to today, and I have to say I'm really pleased with how this turned out, and I think the least I can do is a proper demo. Now, I know I have some hardcore audio files in the audience, and so I spared no expense with the record player, I'm sure you'll agree. This time Hoffman and RMC Retro will be providing the audio, so hopefully there's no risk of a copyright strike. very cool, I hope you'll agree. All the info you need to build your own Pixel Music 3000 is on the link in the description. I'd like to thank Make Magazine and Uncommon Projects for originally putting this out there, and hopefully with this video and the information I've gathered together on my website, we might even see something of a mini revival, which would be very cool to see. So if you enjoyed this project, don't forget to give it a thumbs up and maybe share it with your friends. It's all very much appreciated and helps me to grow the channel. And if you'd like to see more electronics projects like this, as well as my vintage computer restorations and retro gaming stuff, please do consider subscribing. So all that's left is to thank you very much for watching, and I'll hopefully see you again soon.